To the Philippine Benchmark Index now, the PSEI closes at 67.61 after gaining 1.3%. Value turnover was at 5.75 billion pesos. Ron Acoba of Chief Investment Strategist at Trading Edge now joins us for a discussion on the market. Good afternoon, Ron. Welcome again to the Business Roadshow.
Good afternoon, Stanley. Thank you for having me.
All right. It's good to have you here. Now, analysts have been weighing in on the recent stock market performance as being saddled by global headwinds, and you also have weak currency as well as disappointing Q3 earnings. Now, let's talk about those Q3 figures from the top companies. Weren't these the kind of revenue levels that could have propped, investor interest?
Well, the drag in the PSEI that we saw over the last few weeks wasn't so much because of the third quarter corporate figures. As you've mentioned, they're still generally on track to hit double-digit growth for 2024 on average. For me personally, it's more of the major drag was more of driven by the sudden decline of the peso against the US dollar, which in turn led the USD-PHP exchange rate back to the proximity of its all-time high as we speak. As we speak, I think it's doing at around 58.8 at present. So the recent decline in the peso, primarily because of the quick rise in US 10-year yields, is the one that has been leading for foreigners to sell local assets.
Okay, Ron, of course, the win of President Donald Trump, incoming President Donald Trump, was also a factor, at least last week, not just for the Philippines, but for a lot of markets. But are you seeing the Philippine Stock Exchange getting a grip of that reality? And are we beyond or are we past the stage where, there's general uncertainty as to how emerging markets are going to react under a Trump presidency?
Well, obviously, we saw a bit of a negative reaction with regards to his potential policy following his win a couple of weeks ago. And if you remember, it's actually where the PSEI started to decline. And if I remember correctly, from November 5 to last week, the PSEI has declined by about 11%, and one of which is because of the threat that the Trump presidency could mean to emerging markets. So moving forward, there remains to be some degree of uncertainty. Although a part of it is already priced in, given the 13% decline that we saw in the last three to four weeks.
That's right. Because really, even before the U.S. presidential elections, a lot of investors have already been pricing in a Donald Trump win, where we also noted dips even before the election for Philippine stocks. But when you talk about the finish for 2024 at the PSEI, what is Trading Edge's outlook now? Have we reached the peak, or is there still a chance to hit higher than 7,000 or 7,200 at least before 2024 ends or winds down?
Well, at present, while the PSEI has rallied in the last 2 days, we are still in the midst of a corrective phase, having seen the index fall down to 6.5 from a high of 7,554 three or four weeks ago. Unfortunately, for the PSEI to have a more sustainable upleg, it needs to first establish a base, and establishing a base takes a bit of time. So it needs to move sideways, let some bargain hunting actions take place, and once we see that particular base, it's only then that the PSEI can perhaps overcome the 7,000 level once again. So, assuming that the PSEI is in the process of basing as we speak, it may need at least 3 to 4 weeks time of moving sideways.
Okay, now for the PSEI, I've already witnessed at least the end part of the earnings season. We only have at least one positive thing going for us. Of course, the rate cuts are still happening before the year ends, and we're looking at policy easing taking a pause in other economies. The U.S. might slow down on those cuts, but according to Bank of America, the Philippines is still in a good position to proceed as inflation remains on a downward trend. Now, is this enough, Ron, to allay fears that, you know, the recent uptick in our inflation in the consumer print could make the BSP delay those cuts? Or do you feel that the BSP will, in fact, proceed with policy easing in December in spite of the latest inflation numbers?
Well, for me, if you ask me personally, a delay in a rate cut could actually be better from an exchange rate point of view. As I've mentioned, one of the main drag to the performance of the local stock market in the past 3 to 4 weeks was the sudden weakness of the peso relative to the US dollar. So at present, the interest rate differential between the US and the Philippines stands at about 125 bips. So a good scenario would be for the BSP to just be in lockstep with the Fed. A better scenario would be to be able to improve that interest rate differential would be to perhaps delay a cut for at least one meeting, just in order for the peso to be prop up and to attract back some flows because of the improvement in the interest rate differential.
So it's really currency that's going to influence future rate cut decisions, at least the immediate rate cut decisions for the Banco Central. Now, we're talking about inflation now. How are you pricing in, Ron, weather effects on inflation and the general market sentiment? Because we've recently experienced, you know, a string of typhoons, and this has affected agriculture quite significantly in important areas in the Philippines.
Well, definitely the effect of the recent typhoons that we had, especially we saw a string of it just within 2 to 3 weeks time. Definitely, it will show up in the domestic inflation in the next few months, and especially if you look back to last year, the typhoon was more spread across the year relative to this year. So definitely we will see a notable impact to agriculture, hence in local prices.
Okay, going back now to the markets. In closing, you know, we've been seeing selling in the past few weeks. A lot of profit-taking happening at the bourse. Now, if these are risk-off times again, for at least for Philippine equities, where do you think are investors bringing their money?
Well, obviously, this particular theme was the theme present a year or even 2 years ago, where you see a risk-off in the local equities market. So the question is, given that, where do you put your money? Same as before, at present, for example, the government, a one-year government bond yield is still presenting a yield of about 5.85%. Obviously, a corporate bond would offer a yield of better than 5.85%. So those are the windows that are still present, given the risk of sentiment that we're seeing in the stock market, at least.
Okay, Ron, it's unfortunate that is happening. You know, a lot of people have been calibrating investments already for 2025. They already made up their minds, set in those strategies, and then this happens. But for 2025, and for those who are cash rich, if you will, what is the best investment strategy now for next year?
Well, for me, the expected theme for 2025 was actually the expected theme going into 2024. We are still expecting general inflation to come down, hence general level of interest rates to come down. The main difference that we're seeing is actually for the better is that interest rates globally have started to come down. So we are in the early stages of that. So the theme remains to be, for me, to be long in equities, because equities in general would benefit from from a general decline in interest rates, and specifically long and cyclical equities, cyclical stocks, specifically banks and properties, especially now that for example, the property sector was one of the sectors that were heavily sold down in the last 2 to 3 weeks.
And of course, also investing on a lot of dividend plays, I guess, would really counter whatever losses that will be incurred by those investments. Again, Ron Acoba of Trading Edge, thank you so much for joining us this afternoon. Have a great day.
Thank you, Stanley. Have a great day.